हरि ओम सुवर्णा भगिनी, यू कैन स्टार्ट योर सेल्फ म्यूटेड.
नमस्ते भगिनी.
नमस्ते.
ओम पार्थाय प्रतिबोधिताम भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथिताम पुराण मुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीं अम्बत्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीं. नमोस्तुते व्यास विशालबुद्धे फुल्लारविन्दायतपत्रनेत्र येन त्वया भारततैलपूर्णः प्रज्वालितो ज्ञानमयः प्रदीपः. प्रपन्नपारिजाताय स्तोत्रवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः. सर्वोपनिषदो गावः दोग्धा गोपालनन्दनः पार्थो वत्सः सुधीर्भोक्ता दुग्धं गीतामृतं महत् वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुम्. भीष्मद्रोणतटा जयद्रथजला गांधार नीलोत्पला शल्यग्राहवती कृपेण वहनी कर्णेन वेलाकुला अश्वत्थाम विकर्ण घोरमकरा दुर्योधनावर्तिनी सोत्तीर्णा खलु पाण्डवैरणनदी कैवर्त केशवः. पाराशर्यवचः सरोजममलं गीतार्थगन्धोत्कटं नानाख्यानककेसरं हरिकथासम्बोधनाबोधितं लोके सज्जनषट्पदैरहरहः पेपीयमानं मुदा भूयाद्भारतपङ्कजं कलिमलप्रध्वंसिनः श्रेयसे. मूकं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुल्लङ्घयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे परमानन्दमाधवं यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थित तद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यै योगिनः यस्यान्तन्न विदुःसुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः. धन्यवादः भगिनी.
धन्यवादः भगिनी. नारायणं पद्मभुवं वसिष्ठं शक्तिं च तत्पुत्रपराशरं च व्यासं शुकं गौडपदं महान्तं गोविन्दयोगीन्द्रमथास्य शिष्यं श्रीशङ्कराचार्यमतास्य पद्मपादं च हस्तामलकं च शिष्यम्. तम तोटकं वार्तिककारमन्यान् अस्मद्गुरून् सन्ततमानतोऽस्मि श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानामालयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शङ्करं लोकशङ्करम् शङ्करं शङ्कराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणम् सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वन्दे भगवन्तं पुनः पुनः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः सदाशिवसमारम्भाम् शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्ताम् वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् ॐ परं वरिष्ठं ब्रह्मिष्ठं परमानन्दरूपिणम् परमार्थानन्दयतिं सद्गुरुं प्रणतोऽस्म्यहम् Having completed the 17th chapter, we will now enter the 18th and the final chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, which is the largest chapter with 78 verses. And in this chapter, Lord Krishna answers the final question raised by Arjuna. And after answering Arjuna's question, the Lord summarizes the Bhagavad Gita teaching contained in all the previous chapters, beginning from chapter 3 to 17. So as I pointed out in the last class, second chapter is also a summary. 18th chapter is also a summary, right? So Arjuna asked the last question here, a question which he has asked before, and that is regarding sannyasa or renunciation, generally known as a monastic life. Regarding that, Arjuna asks a question and Krishna gives an answer. And that's how this chapter begins. So let's enter the chapter. Arjuna uvacha, sannyasasya mahabaho, tattvam icchami veditum, त्यागस्य च हृषिकेश पृथक्केशिनिषूदन. So Arjuna's question is regarding the renunciation, and Arjuna is interested in the topic of renunciation. If you see the background, it is not because of any spiritual reason that he is interested, but because his duty is very bitter and painful, he wanted renunciation, and he was all the time in the forest for 13 years. If you remember, before they came to the kingdom, and then, you know, had this discussion with the Kauravas, etc., right? So happily he could have taken the decision when they were all in the forest to continue or, you know, take up sannyasa, right? But Arjuna and his brothers came back with a very decisive mind that they must continue with the Mahabharata war, right, which is a Dharma Yuddha, and he wanted to claim the kingdom which is legitimately belonging to him. Therefore, he never had the intention of sannyasa before. And after coming to the battlefield also, right, he obviously wanted to start fighting. That is why in the first chapter, if you see, you have, you know, the description where the conches are blown and all of that, and he's ready to fight. He's in the chariot with Krishna, you know, as the charioteer. And then he actually says, let me go and survey, right? And then he requests Krishna to actually place the chariot in front of the people, right? So, and if you see, he wanted to see the army in front of him. and Lord Krishna placed the chariot. Now, when he placed the chariot in front of his near and dear ones, the sense of attachment overpowered him and he forgot his Swadharma completely. And he wanted to escape from the legitimate war that he had embarked upon. Therefore, when the duty is terrible, thinking of sannyasa is only an escapist sannyasa, which is born out of immaturity. So Arjuna's, that is Arjuna's sense of sannyasa is inappropriate, but he is repeatedly talking to Krishna about sannyasa so that Krishna at least passingly may accept Arjuna. And as Swamiji puts it, you know, the war is close to Delhi or Kurukshetra. So if Krishna just gives an inch, then Arjuna can immediately run away to Rishikesh, right? So Arjuna was wanting, he was trying this last attempt, right, to know about sannyasa once again, so that Krishna may at least permit him now at the very end of the Gita, right? So if you see here, there are two words in Sanskritam for renunciation. One is sannyasa and the other word is tyagaha. And both words mean renunciation only. Therefore, they are synonyms only. But Arjuna wants to know whether both are same or is there any subtle difference. Therefore, he asks, right, Arjuna Vacha, Hey Mahabaho, addressing the Lord, O Lord Krishna, sannyasasya tattvam veditum icchami, right? I want to understand the scriptural or the spiritual significance of the concept of sannyasa or renunciation. Now, Arjuna has heard of the word tyaga also. Therefore, he asks, tyagasya cha. Basically, I want to know what is sannyasa and I want to know what is tyaga also, right? Basically, I want to understand veditum aham icchami about both tyaga and sannyasa. And prithak, prithak here means distinctly. I want to know the difference, right? He Keshi Nishudana, right? He Keshi Nishudana is the name of Lord Krishna, right? Exactly like Madhusudana. Keshi Nishudana means the destroyer of the Rakshasa named Keshi. Exactly like Madhusudana refers to the destroyer of the Rakshasa Madhu. So this is Arjuna's question and Krishna wants to answer. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha, Kamyanam Karmanam Nyasam, Kamyanam Karmanam Nyasam, Sanyasam kavayo viduhu, sanyasam kavayo viduhu, sarva karma phalatyagam, sarva karma phalatyagam, prahustyagam vichakshanaha, prahustyagam vichakshanaha. Lord Krishna is reserving his own answer for later discussions. So, Krishna's comments will start only from the fourth verse. So, in the second and third verse, Krishna is giving us other views, right? And Krishna is not going to totally agree with them, right? But he is objectively presenting the opinion of others. So, he says there are some people who say the meaning of the word sannyasa and tyagaha are slightly different, even though they both mean renunciation only, right? A particular type of renunciation is called sannyasa and another particular type of renunciation is called tyagaha. Thus, there are some people who make a difference based on what we renounce, and renunciation being the same, which is renounced will, whatever is being renounced, right, it will decide whether it is sannyasa or tyagaha. So he says, Krishna says, thus some people declare, right, not that Krishna declares, but some people, right. So, in the Veda Purva Bhaga or the first part of the Veda, it talks about varieties of religious activities, right? So, Puja, Visopancha Mahayagnya, Deva Yagnya, right? So, Karma means action and religious activities consisting of Puja, right? Japa, prayer, ritual, etc. Generally called Karma, and it appears in the வேத பூர்வ பாகா அண்ட் இஸ் கால் கர்மகாண்டா. அந்த வேத பூர்வ பாகா வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட் போர்ஷன் டாக்ஸ் அபவுட் வெரைட்டிஸ் ஆஃப் கர்மாஸ், விஹித கர்மா, நிஷித்த கர்மா, காமிய கர்மா அண்ட் பிராயஷ்சித்த கர்மா. When we were learning, Swamiji used to go back and forth between these karmas and it was very difficult to place them. So therefore, I just put them as a list here. Try and focus on these four now so that you will enjoy the next two verses much better. Okay. So vihita karma means those prayers and religious activities which the scriptures prescribe as regular duties or compulsory duties of a Hindu, obligatory duties. That means why obligatory? As a Hindu in a particular ashrama, they are compulsory duties, right? So like Pancha Mahayajna, etc., which are not presented as optional, right? Vihitam means we are bound by the scriptural injunction, exactly like a citizen of a country is expected to pay the tax, right? So a very important point here, it is not optional. So vihita karma is also called niyata karma. You will often hear these words being used, right? So, and if a Hindu who is supposed to do certain vihita karmas and niyata karmas is not doing that, for omitting, there is a special type of papam, which is called pratyavaya papam, okay? So pratyavaya papam. It lead to spiritual downfall if you do not do vihita karma or niyata karma. This is one type of karma. Then the second type of karma is called kamya karma, which are optional karmas, right? Prescribed for the fulfillment of worldly desires. It has nothing to do with spirituality, but I've got certain desires, right? The Veda itself, Taittiriya Aranyakam says, Pashu kama chindita, vitta kama chindita, amayavi chindita, brahma varchasaha, kama chindita. Basically, if you want to have a magnetic personality, do this ritual. If you want money, do this ritual. If you want lot of house, cows, you know, farm, etc., do this, etc. There are plenty of karmas available in the Veda Purva Bhaga. The whatever I said is all available in the Taittiriya Aranyakam. These are all kamya karmas. Why kamya? Because you are desiring something and you pray for that. You're using religion and prayer for sakama bhakti. Basically, sakama means you are expecting something in return, and so you are doing putra kameshti agam. All of this come under kamya karma. Then we've got karma which is called nishiddha karma, right? Those we are not supposed to do, like telling a lie, harming others, right? Cheating people, consuming liquor, consuming meat, etc. They're all nishiddha karmas, called prohibited karmas. And doing those karmas will also give papam and bring about spiritual downfall. You must remember this is with respect to spiritual downfall, okay? So they are called nishiddha karma. Then the next type of karma is called prayachitta karma, prayashchitta, or parihara karma. So if there are certain papams of the purva janma which is affecting our present life, then we try to identify the type of papam by appropriate method and then do parihara. Right? So it's called parihara karma or prayashchitta karma. Thus vihita karma, right? Then you have kamya karma, you have nishiddha karma, then you have prayaschitta karma. So varieties of karmas are there, and based on this the definition is given and here in this verse. And some Vedic scholars say that all the kamya karmas, right, note this, all the kamya karmas and nishiddha karmas should be renounced by a spiritual person, right? Both these, the second bullet and the third bullet here, right? So based on that definition given, the way some Vedic scholars say that all kamya karmas and nishiddha karmas should be renounced by a spiritual seeker, avoid performance of pujas, prayers, etc., for the sake of worldly benefit. So gradually reduce them is what the Shastra says. And if a person is renouncing those karmas, especially the kamya karmas, that is the worldly desires prompted prayers and puja, it is very good. And that is called sannyasaha. So kamya karma varjanam is sannyasaha, some people declare. So here in the first line you see, kamyanam karmanam nyasam, renunciation of the kamya karmas, right? So only kamya karmas should be avoided, right? Of course, we should avoid nishiddha karma, right? Obviously, prohibited ones you should definitely not do. The nitya naimittika karmas or vihita karmas, the compulsory or obligatory duties like pancha mahayajna must be performed. Then Veda offers two types of benefits for these compulsory duties, vihita karmas. You have to compulsorily do them, right? And if we do them, Veda offers punya phalam. Now you have two options, Veda says. One is called materialistic punyam, a punyam which can be encashed for worldly benefit, right? So you do pancha mahayajna, the same karma can be used, that punyam can be encashed for material growth or spiritual growth. You can do it for the sake of your child's marriage, your own, you know, profession, career advancement, or you can do it for sadhana chatushtaya sampatti, jnana vairagya siddhyartham, etc., which is spiritual growth, right? So sandhya vandanam, your nitya puja in the morning, etc., you can do it for, do it with a sankalpa like sarve bhavantu sukhinaha, sarve santu niramayaha. Right? For the lokakshema, you can perform these daily puja, nitya puja itself. So if a spiritual seeker does not use the karma for worldly benefit, renunciation of the worldly benefit, right, for the vihita karma which you are doing, that is phalatyagam. I hope it's clear. Kamya karma is selfish karma that you do specifically for putra kameshtiyagam, those kind of things. That renunciation is sannyasa. The phalam renunciation, the result renunciation of the compulsory duties that you do, right? You have to do. You can't renounce those sandhya vandanam and your daily prayers, aditya hridayam, all of that. Those prayers when you do, right, vihita karma, the results when you encash for spiritual growth or you say loka samasta sukhino bhavantu, that is karma phalatyagaha. Okay, so that is tyagaha, right? So you must remember the subtle difference between both, and that is what is said here in this verse number 2. Continuing, tyajyam doshavadityeke, tyajyam doshavadityeke, karma prahur manishinah, karma prahur manishinah, यज्ञदानतपकर्मा तपकर्मा न त्याज्यमिति चापरे, न त्याज्यमिति चापरे. Now another debate or topic is there in the same context, and there also scholars have their own opinions. Krishna wants to present that also. Previously the difference was between sannyasa and tyaga, right? And people make a subtle difference. Now the discussion is with regard to obligatory duties prescribed by the Shastra. Should they be done compulsorily by all or can they be renounced? That is another debate. In previous shloka, we talked about kamya karma tyagaha. Here the debate is about vihita karma tyagaha. The compulsory duties itself, like sandhya vandanam, daily prayer, etc., right? That itself, can you give up, right? So here also there are two opinions. First opinion is karma tyajyam, all the karmas including vihita karmas should be renounced, and one should, right, go away from all the karmas, and according to them any karma is bondage and it is going to produce punyam or papam, and if it produces punyam also you will have Punarapi maranam, punarapi jananam, right? Therefore, all the karmas will perpetuate the cycle of samsara. Therefore, right, one may be an iron bondage, the other may be a golden bondage. Therefore, all of them are bonds only. So, therefore, karma, tyajyam, here karma refers to vihita karma, right? The compulsory duties which should be renounced. Why? Doshavat. Because all the karmas, right, will bind a person by causing punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam cycle. Iti manishinaha, some scholars declare thus. Whereas some other scholars in the opposite side say, no, these karmas should not be renounced. Kamya karma may be renounced. Nishiddha karma, obviously, even prayaschitta karma you can avoid. Vihita karma should never be renounced under any circumstance because Shastra prescribes them as compulsory and obligatory for the ashrama that you belong to. So, if you renounce these duties, you will get Pratyavaya Papam, right? That is the special name given. Therefore, the second group say, Pare, they are also scholars, Yajna Dana Tapak Karma, right? The compulsory duties mentioned and analyzed in chapter 17, right? That we saw the different types of Yajna, Karma, Yajna, Dana, Tapa, etc., right? Regular puja and charity, austerity, etc., should never be renounced. Iti apare, some other people declare. In short, there is a lot of confusion regarding renunciation topic. So, up to this is the opinion of various scholars. Hereafter alone, Krishna is going to give his comments. Nishchayam shunu me tatra. Nishchayam shunu me tatra. Tyage bharata sattama. Tyage bharata sattama. Tyago hi purusha vyagra. Tyago hi purusha vyagra. Trividasam prakirtitah. Krishna is going to give his comments, and while giving his comments, Krishna is going to suppress the original concept of sannyasa. Why? Because he knows the background. He knows Arjuna is not ready for the original sannyasa, and if Krishna talks about that, Arjuna may take shelter under the sannyasa and try to escape from his duties. Since Krishna does not want Arjuna to escape from the duties, the original concept of renunciation, which is well known in the Indian culture, which is popular, right, which is called the fourth ashrama of life, Krishna does not want to talk about, right? So that is Brahmacharya ashrama, Grihastha ashrama, Vanaprastha ashrama, and Sannyasa ashrama, the fourth one. So, because this is the final stage of renunciation after you have contributed to the family, right? You have made sure that everybody is settled, you have completed all your duties, etc., right? Until then, you are supposed to perform Karma Yoga, Upasana Yoga, all of them. Vedanta talks about the possibility of the fourth stage where a person can give up all the worldly duties and take to a monastic lifestyle. Such an option is there. Not to escape from duties, but after the proper completion of duties, right? So, in extraordinary cases, of course, Shastra permits people to not enter the Grihastha Ashrama, directly go from Brahmacharya Ashrama to Sannyasa Ashrama. For that, obviously, the Guru has to watch the student, observe the student, and then grant this Sannyasa to such a student. Why? Because that person wants to exclusively focus on Vedanta Shravana Manana Nididhyasana. So, Sannyasa Ashrama is also known as Turiya Ashrama, right? So, such ashrama discussed in the Veda, and there are a set of Upanishads also called Sannyasa Upanishads for this purpose, okay? So, Swamiji actually says that without that inclination, if you get into Sannyasa Ashrama, it is very difficult. It is a one-way street. You cannot come back. And it can be detrimental to the society itself if you have wrong role models of sannyasis, right? So, therefore, Krishna does not want to discuss that monastic lifestyle here, right? Because Arjuna is not ready for that. and Krishna knows that if he talks about it, Arjuna will misuse that also. So Krishna wants to give a new definition to sannyasa in the following verses. So the first point he wants to convey is the word tyagaha and sannyasa are synonyms only. Both refer to renunciation only. That means Krishna does not agree with the third shloka, in which there was a subtle difference talked between sannyasa and tyaga, right? So kamya karma renunciation was called sannyasa, and vihita karma phala renunciation is tyagaha. So this subtle distinction some scholars made, Lord Krishna does not agree with that classification. In his vision, sannyasa and tyaga both mean renunciation only. So this is a very important point. Sannyasa and tyaga can be interchangeably used, right? So Krishna will use it interchangeably, being synonymous, right? Then, having communicated that, Krishna introduces a special topic which is very unique to the 18th chapter of the Gita, not discussed elsewhere, and that topic is sannyasa, otherwise known as tyagaha, can be divided into three. And now Krishna has this hangover of the 17th chapter. If you remember 17th chapter, everything he divided into three: sattvika, rajasika and tamasika, right? Sattvika, rajasa, tamasa, right? So here also you do that, right? Because Krishna is in a mood to divide anything into the same three categories, right? So he's on this classification spree. So you will see the rest of the shlokas also go on like that, right? So now here he says, right, indirect messages, you must avoid tamasika, you must reduce rajasika, and you must go in for sattvika, right? So now the question is, these three types, right, tamasa, rajasa, sattvika, sannyasa, what are they, right? So here, hey Bharata Sattama, the greatest one in the Bharata lineage or family, Arjuna belongs to that family. Sattama meaning Sreshtaha, right? Nishchayam Shunu, may you clearly listen and get your conviction. Tatra Tyage, with regard to the topic of Tyaga, which is the same as we should remember as Sannyasa, right? May you listen to my verdict, right? Abhinna Tyaga, right? So the first message I'm giving is, hey Purusha Vyagraha, right? Sannyasa and Tyaga is the same. So Krishna is using them as Sannyasa Abhinna Tyaga. Then he says, hey Purusha Vyagraha. In Tamil, they'll say, right, Surapuli, right? So it is like, he is a tiger, O tiger among men. Vyagra means tiger or tiger, right? So you refer to someone who is an expert as tiger. So Purusha Vyagra means Purusha Shrestha, right? Tyagaha is Trividaha Samprakirtitaha, is divided into three classes or three types. Now Arjuna is curious. He wants to know what are the three things.
Yajnadana tapakarma. Natyajyam karyameva tat. Natyajyam karyameva tat. Yajnodanam tapaschaiva. Yajnodanam tapaschaiva. Pavanani manishinam.
So in the fourth shloka, Krishna has given his verdict, right? With regard to the second shloka, right? In the second shloka, the scholars differed in the meaning of the word sannyasa and tyaga. In the fourth verse, Krishna has refuted the difference by indicating that both are the same. Therefore, second shloka has been clarified in the fourth shloka. Now, in the third shloka, there was a discussion on, you remember, it was on the vihita karma, right? Obligatory duties, can they be renounced or not? One group said karmas can be renounced and another group said vihita karmas should not be renounced in the third verse. So now Krishna is giving this verdict. Okay, very important. What is that? He says, vihita karmas should never be renounced. As long as you are in the society, you are in the family, any ashrama for that matter, the obligatory prayers in the form of Panchay Mahayajna, right? Never renounce, right? So daily you should give at least 2 or 3 minutes, if not physical puja, at least Shiva Manasa puja, anything, right? You have to do. And we have to share our resources with others. Danam is very, very important. So yajna, dana, tapaha. Tapaha is moderation and self-control. And whenever we start indulging in any worldly pleasures, right, we can certainly enjoy good food, good dress, etc. But over indulgence can lead to addiction, right? Addiction need not be only for alcohol, even any type of indulgence. Serial watching, what they say, binge watching, right? That is also addiction only, right? So a spiritual seeker wants freedom. If I can't give up something like a serial or TV, then where is the question of giving up on anything else like samsara, right? How would that be possible? Therefore, to avoid addiction, now and then I have to say no to certain things. I should be comfortable in self-denial, right? So willful self-denial to establish my mastery over my mind and sense organs, right? So that's the definition of tapas, right? So willful self-denial, saying no, to establish mastery over my sense organs and mind, that is austerity, right? We've got several rituals and festivals, even daily, right? If you decide that you will eat only after completing morning prayers, right? And only after a bath and prayers, you will do that, right? So that itself is a self-denial only, right? So Shastra says, start the day with some prayer or puja, and after snanam, you wait, and then you take food after prayers, right? So therefore, Krishna says, yajna, pancha maha yajna, danam, sharing the resources, tapaha, self-control or self-restraint and austerity, natyajyam, may you never give up, right? Don't say, you know, I am a jnani, I am beyond everything, I am akarta, abhokta, so I will not do that. No. As long as you are in society, these are compulsory duties. That's why I said it depends on the ashrama. If you are in grihastha ashrama, you are expected to perform all those duties, right? So, all these lead to mental purification, which is a prerequisite for receiving the knowledge, retaining the knowledge, assimilating the knowledge, and deriving the benefit, right? So, I may not understand Vedanta initially, right? Basically, in the initial days, our mind is not as refined. Then over the years, by doing all of these, you know, yajna, dana, tapa, meditation, japa, everything, right? Then you sort of, the mental refinement happens. Therefore, pavanani means chitta shodakani, manishinam, for those intelligent seekers, as even you study Vedanta and you continue with vihita karma, right? To perform the home duties also and continue with the Vedantic studies also. So basically, Krishna wants to say that karma should not be renounced. Very important verse, right? In verse 5.
Etanyapitu karmani, etanyapitu karmani, sangam tyaktva phalani cha. Sangam tyaktva phalani cha kartavyani ti me partha, kartavyani ti me partha, nishchitam matamuttamam, nishchitam matamuttamam.
Exactly like the 17th chapter classification, the threefold sannyasa Krishna is presenting from the 7th verse onwards. But before presenting the threefold sannyasa, Lord Krishna makes a very general and important observation, which is going to be disappointing to Arjuna. He wants to make it very clear. He says, yajna, danam and tapa are compulsory and you can never renounce. Yajna means pancha maha yajna, which are the duties of a grihastha, by pointing out that these can never be renounced, Krishna is going to point out. So Lord Krishna says, Arjuna, you cannot get away from the family. you cannot get away from this war also, which is one of your duties as a kshatriya. Therefore, every spiritual seeker should diligently follow yajna. Yajna means pancha maha yajna, contribution to the infrastructure, and danam means sharing of our resources, whether it is tangible or intangible resources, right? It can be wealth, it can be knowledge, it can be time. Tapaha, representing all forms of discipline mentioned in the 13th chapter, Amanitvam, Adambitvam, and the 16th chapter, Daivi Sampat, Abhayam Sattva Samshuddhihi, all forms of disciplines, physical disciplines, like getting up early, regularly, you know, getting up before sunrise, then the eating discipline, the sleeping discipline, a talking discipline, right? We saw NTUC, non-hurtful, truthful, useful, and cheerful. Anudvega karam vakyam, satyam hitam priyam. We saw all of that. Okay? So, and you have to observe the tongue discipline, and all forms of disciplines will come under tapaha. Yajna, danam, and tapa, you can never give up, Arjuna. Krishna says, so, etani apitu karmani kartavyani. Krishna says, etani means yajna, dana, tapa. When you do them, may you never get attached to the karma, right? Don't get attached to the karma, because sometimes you may not be able to do that karma also. So, any raga is harmful, right? So, for instance, Swamiji says, you know, there are people, very old people who come to the class. Now, Swamiji is teaching for 30 years, 35 years. They are also coming for so long. Now, at some point in time, they may become very old and they may not even be able to attend the classes in person. Even that is a form of an attachment, right? So, that is what Krishna is referring to here. Whatever you do, enjoy doing as long as you can, but never get attached to any karma. There are people who say, right, that on Friday I do 4-5 hours of puja and I am not able to get out of it now and my knees start troubling me, etc. Right? So, at the appropriate time, we need to also reduce some of these and do maybe manasa puja, etc. Because you are not able to do so many namaskaras, etc. Right? So, you may become physically unfit also, right? So, never get attached to anything. So, you don't have to drop it first. So, the idea here is raga is a problem. Therefore, sangam tyaktva phalanicha. And for all these pancha mahayajnas, again, you can encash the results for spiritual benefit or material benefit. So, here it says, may you diligently use them for spiritual benefit. Jnana vairagya siddhyartham aham karishye. May you practice that, right? Kartavyani, and may you do them. Nishchitam matam uttamam. This is my verdict regarding sannyasa and tyaga. That means whatever you renounce, yajna, dana, tapa, karma, you cannot renounce. So the next question will be, then what should I renounce? If this I can't renounce, right? So that alone Krishna is going to elaborate from the 7th verse onwards.
नियतस्तु सन्यासः नियतस्य तु सन्यासः कर्मणो नोपपद्यते कर्मणो नोपपद्यते मोहातस्य परित्यागः मोहातस्य परित्यागः तामसः परिकीर्तितः तामसः परिकीर्तितः.
Now Krishna wants to classify sannyasa into three types, and the word sannyasa can be replaced by the word tyaga also, because in Krishna's vision both are synonymous. So in the 17th chapter, when he classified it into sattvika, rajasa and tamasa, he followed a particular order. First sattvika, then rajasa, then tamasa. But here in this particular context, Krishna is following the reverse order, right, to drill a very important point for Arjuna. First, he defines tamasa sannyasaha. He says, renunciation of yajna, danam and tapaha, which are compulsory for a grihastha, that will incur papam. And that papam is pratyavaya papam, and it is very, very important for spiritual growth that we don't have this papam, right? So if you renounce, right, that renunciation will come under Tamasa Sannyasa. Therefore, Arjuna, if you run away from this battle, you will be renouncing, all right, but that renunciation will come under Tamasika renunciation. Therefore, never think of running away from this battlefield. Therefore, he says, Niyatasya Karmanah Sannyasah. The renunciation, right, of the enjoined karma, that is compulsory, right, the obligatory duties, Karmanah Sannyasah or Tyagah, Na Upapadyate, is never appropriate, right? So, is never right. Mohaha, out of delusion, suppose you renounce, and if you do not know the importance, because moksha requires jnanam, and jnanam requires mental purification. That mental purification comes from yajna dana tapa. And if this particular importance you don't know, and out of delusion you renounce, here moha means ajnanam. Because of the ignorance of the value of this nitya naimittika karma, right? Because you are ignorant of it, right? So why do we renounce many of the wonderful duties that our forefathers followed? They got up early in the morning during Brahma Muhurtam. They did meditation, they did puja, they performed Sandhya Vandanam. The lady of the house also had work, like cleaning the, you know, the kitchen, you know, the stove, and making sure that, you know, we prayed to the Agni, and then we, you know, cleaned the puja room, lit the lamps. So both had the roles to play, right? And they got up early in the morning and they did all of that, right? So the lady had her own regular duties, the husband had his own duties, right? Now, if the present generation is renouncing them because we have ourselves not paid enough importance to it, and therefore it is happening. And what is happening is we are also laying overemphasis on studies and, you know, running behind admissions, etc., because material pursuit is also becoming important and wealth is becoming very, very critical, right? So at the cost of all of this, we have got the material benefits. That's the problem. So Veda says that they are all important, but for internal growth, for ultimate peace, security and happiness, that is not dependent on the number of houses or the wealth or the cars that you have. It is the inner wealth alone which is the source of peace, security and happiness. And therefore, the ignorance of the truth behind yajna dana tapaha, right, the value of yajna dana tapaha, that ignorance is called mohaha. Okay, so in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, Yajnavalkya wants to take sannyasa. So when he calls his wife Maitreyi and says, you know, I have all these cows and, you know, all the dakshinas and the gold that I received from Janaka, I'm going to give them all to you and I want to renounce. Then Maitreyi asked the question, right, will all these things give me fulfillment and peace, right? So Yajnavalkya says, yata eva upakaranavatam jivitam tata eva te jivitam syat amrutatvasya tu nashasti vittena iti. Maitreyi had asked, yena aham na amrutasyam kim aham tena kuryam. What will I do with the wealth? She was such a great you know, wife who was herself a Brahmavadini, who understood this much to challenge her husband, saying, what will I do with all this wealth? I don't want that. But she will later on ask for Brahma Vidya itself. And then Maitreyi goes with in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, he goes with Yajnavalkya, and Yajnavalkya becomes the guru, right? Katyayani is the other wife who stays behind, right? So she's not appearing in all these discussions subsequently. Continuing, dukkamityeva yat karma, dukkamityeva yat karma, kayaklesha bayatyajet, sakritva rajasam tyagam, sakritva rajasam tyagam, naiva tyagha balam labhet,
naiva tyaga phalam labhe.
Now Krishna defines the rajasika renunciation, right, which is also inappropriate renunciation only, right? So tamasik and rajasik are inferior ones, satvik alone is superior. Now he talks about rajasik renunciation. Here also a person renounces the very very precious yajna, dana and tapaha, saying this we all can relate, no time for puja, no time for japa, no time for prayer, right? In fact, Kanchi Acharya says that once a week as a family can you pray together, right? So all family members together once a week or once a fortnight or once a month, or we can say at least let's have satsanga, right? So this yajna, danam and tapa, by giving one excuse or the other, when it is renounced, it is inappropriate. So in rajasik tyaga also one renounces yajna, dana, tapa, right? And only difference is here the reason given is different, very subtle difference. There was the ignorance of the values. Here the values are known very clearly. He is sufficiently informed and he knows that it can give him chitta shuddhi, sadhana chatushtaya, sampatti, jnana yogyata prapti, all of that, right? But what does he say? Sheer laziness, right? He says, oh, my leg will pain. Actually, that's too much of work. Why actually do all this? Instead, you can just do manasa puja or something and go away. Let's not do all these rituals. It's a lot of work, right? So that's the kind of attitude. And ajnanam is not the problem, but laziness or over-attachment to the body is the problem. Deha abhimanaha or sharira abhimanaha, right? So that is rajoguna. So rajoguna janya deha abhimana is the cause for the rajasa tyagaha, the rajasa kind of tyagaha. Oh, my namaskara will hurt my back, you know, I might have too much strain, you know, I'm very weak, etc. Right? So these are reasons which are given, right? So we have to regularly go to the temple and do these, you know, going around the praharam, etc., so that our body will be fit doing sashtanga namaskarams, etc. So therefore Krishna says dukkam iti eva, with the fear of physical strain, concerned about the physical strain. Dukkam refers to physical strain. Kaya klesha bhayat, because of the concern of the kaya klesha, means shariram, the strain to the shariram, because of the fear of physical strain and the anxiety, karma tyaje, the one who renounces all the karmani, right? So that is the kind of that is rajasam tyagam, right? So he'll say, why should I go to the temple, you know, Bhagavan is in the heart, etc. So this kind of speaking, because he is lazy by nature, right? So saha rajasam yagam kritva, he will, so that is what is renunciation. Naiva tyaga phalam labet, he will not get any benefit at all, even if he wears a ochre robe, right? So he will not get the benefit of sannyasa. So this is rajasa sannyasa, right? So now sattvika sannyasa we are going to see. Karyam ityeva yat karma, karyam ityeva yat karma, niyatam kriyate arjuna, niyatam kriyate arjuna, sangam tyaktva phalam chaiva, sangam tyaktva phalam chaiva, satyaga satviko matah, satyaga satviko matah. So the first rule is karyam iti nityam kriyate, right? A sattvika sannyasi performs yajna, dana, tapak karma. Personal duties he performs, family duties he performs. He has to go out and earn wealth. He has to preserve his family, right? And earning is required for also danam, which is compulsory. Therefore, everything he does diligently. Whenever he gets tired also, he tells himself, karyam iti evayat. As long as I live, just as I eat, it is important, as the maintenance of the body is also important, and these karmas are also important, right? So we don't renounce our eating, right? So similar to that, we have to treat them exactly like eating, breathing, etc. Therefore, no excuse for these karyams. So niyatvam karma kriyate and satyagaha satvika mataha. So that is called satvika sannyasa. So naturally the question will come, how can you call it sannyasa when he is performing the karma? Because he has renounced something here, right? So Krishna is talking of twofold renunciation. One is sangam tyaktva, attachment to the karma you renounce, because any attachment is inappropriate, and also phalam cha eva, or the phalam also you renounce, right? So these are karmas not for enhancing external possessions, right? Therefore, attachment or leaning upon external possessions, you renounce that, but do them for your own internal growth. Don't concentrate upon what you have, concentrate upon what you are, right? So the more I depend on external factors, the more is the samsara. So remember, nothing in the world is stable, right? And that I must not lean on them. So phalam is the external dependence may you renounce. Phalam chaiva yah karma niyatvam kriyate satyagaha satvikaha mataha. So with regard to the external result, right, Krishna has said before itself, karmanyeva adhikaraha te ma phaleshu kadachana. I can only perform my duty and I accept whatever result I get as Ishvara prasadaha, right? So whatever happens, even raising children up to a certain stage, I can raise the children well and, you know, feel happy about their achievements, etc. But after that, at one stage, if they don't listen to you and they have a mind of their own, Swamiji keeps on saying, do not complain, do not criticize. Don't feel that you have spent all your time bringing them up, etc. That is over. You've enjoyed the journey, right? Don't complain now. Don't expect anything, right? Your duty is to bring them up. That is for internal growth. And if they don't come to me, it is fine. Take it as natural sannyasa given by Bhagavan. So Swamiji says, if children don't come back to you, take it as natural sannyasa, right? It is children's duty to show gratitude, but parents cannot demand it, right? The children should show naturally, but parents can't demand it, right? And I take whatever I get as prasada. And for the internal growth, this is very, very important. Therefore, phalam chaiva satyagaha satvika mata karmani eva adhikaraha. So if you study the definition of satvika sannyasa, interesting thing to notice, satvika sannyasa is same as the karma yoga talked about in the third chapter, right? So generally what happens is, by the time you come to the 18th chapter, you've forgotten the third chapter. But very important that we must remember that satvika sannyasa is just another name for karma yoga only. Therefore, Arjuna, you are fit now for satvika sannyasa or karma yoga. So fight the Mahabharata war, right? You don't know how many people will survive on both sides. Whatever happens, decide to accept that. With this satvika sannyasa, right, Krishna has now defined the three types of sannyasa, and Krishna wants Arjuna to take up satvika sannyasa. Nadveshtya kushalam karma, nadveshtya kushalam karma, kushalena anushajyate, tyagi sattva samavishtah, tyagi sattva samavishtah, medhavi chinna samshayah, medhavi chinna samshayah. Once I decide to become a sattvika sannyasi or a karma yogi, I'm going to focus on my contribution rather than what I'm going to get in return. Contribution to the family, to the society, to the corporate that I work, right? I can work hard enough, right? Whether the expected promotion will come or not, I'm not sure, right? So ultimately, I may work hard and somebody else may get the results, right? But invisible internal promotion in the form of jnana yogyata prapti, that nobody can take away, right? So I am enriching myself internally, and that should be an incentive for me to do what I have to do. So the incentive is that I am growing internally. Therefore, according to Gita, the internal promotion is very, very important, and it is never doubtful. It will happen if we are able to practice this kind of sattvika sannyasa. So that is why Krishna said in the second chapter, Neha Vikrama Nashosti Pratyavayona Vidyate. Internal spiritual growth is never doubtful whether external promotion comes or not. Right? This is the first important point. The next important point that Krishna wants to give is all duties that we want to do, we have to do, will not be equally pleasant. Duties are pleasant as well as unpleasant, right? Both kinds are there, right? And we have to do both, especially when we are working for corporates. There are many things we enjoy, but some of the duties we don't enjoy. It is very painful also. Krishna says, never classify duty to pleasant and unpleasant. That is a very big mistake, right? And you have to convert them into Nevedyam or Ishvara Aradhana. So that is why we say Ishvara Prityartham, right? So very, very important point here. So Parameshwara Prityartham, we say Ishtadevata Prityartham, etc. So the duty that we are doing is for Chitta Shuddhi, and which I will definitely get. Therefore, Ishvara Prityartham and Duritakshayartham, that is why comes with compulsory duties, right? So the Sankalpa is Duritakshaya Dwara, which is the incentive, Parameshwara Prityartham. Therefore, Krishna gives a warning here, Akushalam Karma, right? The unpleasant duties one has to perform, Nadveshti, he does not bang his head saying, you know, oh my God, why am I having to do that? He finds his own motivation to do this, right? Even if it is boring, right? Whether it is office work or family work, or, you know, keeping the home clean, doing cooking, keeping the kitchen clean, any of those family duties, corporate duties or society duties, any of them, right? If I have some boring work also, convert them into something that is interesting and say it is Ishvara, Ishvara Arpana Bhava, and with Ishvara Prasada Bhava, when we work, the karma becomes very different, right? So therefore, learn to innovate and enjoy whatever work we are doing, right? Find our own motivation. Therefore, Krishna says, never hate a duty, because then life will become a drudgery. So Krishna wants to underline this, because now Arjuna's duty is the most unpleasant duty, because he has to actually destroy his own kith and kin, right? And with whom he has intense attachment, and life will not normally involve unpleasant duties too. So never hate them. Kushalena anushajjate, right? When they are so-called pleasant duties, also don't get attached to them, right? For instance, the grandchildren are growing up, we enjoy them. But after they grow up, they may or they may not want to, you know, spend time with you. So don't get overly attached, right? So such a person is called Tyagi, Karma Yogi, and Sattvika Sannyasi are both the referring to the same person. So Sattva Samavishtaha, who is established in Sattva Guna, avoiding Rajasa and Tamasa Sannyasa, he abides in Sattva Guna. So Krishna says Karma Yoga itself, right, is not the final sadhana, but it is for sadhana chatushtaya sampatti and jnana yogyata prapti, right? So even with regular puja, nama sankirtanam, right, any of them, they all can give us only chitta shuddhi. Finally, you need shravanam, mananam and nididhyasanam for moksha. So a proper karma yoga will give desire for Vedantic study, and then, you know, we can go on this path of shravanam, mananam and nididhyasanam, then understand the nature of jiva, jagat and ishvara, and then understand the how the whole world evolves and what is atma, what is anatma, etc., right? So extremely important to convert, right? This and so therefore Sattvika Sannyasi means karma yoga, and it is based on Shraddha, and it should be converted to knowledge finally, to Jnana Yoga finally, then that will complete the spiritual sadhana, right? So we'll stop here. There are a whole lot of topics which are going to be divided into Sattvika, Rajasika, Tamasika before Krishna sums up the Karma Yoga and Jnana Yoga. Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Please note the change in timings from 1st May onwards. I think there are some questions. I have seen many people in the corporate world use Gita as a reason to behave unethically, like engaging in petty politics, citing duty, karma yoga, need of the hour, etc. I'm not sure how to place this in the context of Bhagavad Gita. See, when we are involved in karma yoga, we should not lose sight of the values that we've been taught in the 13th chapter and 16th chapter. So if you kind of let go of adambitvam, the dambitvam and manitvam, right? If you sort of adambitvam, amanitvam, and then satyam, hitam, himsa, ahimsa, all of this we have to be very, very careful about not dropping when we are doing our karma yoga. So if this is misplaced, if you remember all of these, then you will not be engaging in petty politics. Rather, you will be looking at the big picture with Ishwararpana Bhavaha. I hope this answers your question, Nilanjana. Any other questions from anybody else? Okay, I don't see any more hands raised. Okay, so we will stop here and we'll continue next week. Hari Om.